Disruptive Enterprises presents Breaking All the Rules, an ancient framework for modern faith by Kristian A. Smith, MBA, MDiv, narrated by Kristian A. Smith at Truth Studios with Brandon Pear.
Breaking All the Rules, an ancient framework for modern faith by Kristian A. Smith, read by Kristian A. Smith. Dedication. This book is dedicated to my late father, Willie James Smith Sr. I exist because of you. I am who I am because of you. I do what I do because of you. Your spirit lives in me. Your body may not be here, but your spirit will never die. I love you, Pops. Acknowledgements. This entire project has been a communal effort, including the people that shared in raising me, like my mom, Toni Smith, my godmom, Linda Daniels, my god sister, Quita Russ, my siblings, Will and Kelly, my nieces, my nephew, my grandparents, uncles, aunties, and cousins on the Robinson side and Smith side of my family. This effort also includes those whose relationships continue to sustain me daily, like my beautiful wife and life partner, Pamela Merritt. I don't know if anyone believes in me like Pamela does, and it means the world to me. My friends who helped me work through life and the process of writing include Arthur Humphrey, Myron Randall, Tiger Gibson, Stephen Thurston Jr., Dr. Greg DeLoach, Dr. Geneva Gray, Grayson Hester, and Kervance D. Ross. To my present and former pastors who have helped shape my ministry over the years, my late uncle, Pastor Gordon Humphrey Jr., my spiritual father, Pastor T.C. Johnson, a.k.a. Pop, Bishop Eric Hutton, Dr. E. Dewey Smith, and Pastor Spencer O'Neill. To the entire faculty and staff of McAfee School of Theology at Mercer University, thank you for equipping me with the tools to do this meaningful work. Also, to my beloved alma mater, Alabama A&M University, blessed be thy name, long live thy fame. To Brandon Pear and Truth Productions for helping to bring this audiobook to life, I appreciate you. And last but not least, to my church, the faith community, thank you for trusting my leadership as we take this faith journey together. We are changing the world. Foreword by Reginald Wayne Sharp Jr. As a young, precocious student at Morehouse College majoring in religion, I recall sitting in Introduction to Theology class taught by Dr. Aaron L. Parker. This class made an unerasable impact in my life because for the first time, I was introduced to the concept that wrestling with one's faith is a noble undertaking. That was unsettling and unnerving considering all of my life. I was comfortable rehearsing what pastors and Sunday school teachers had taught me. Dr. Parker, who earned a PhD in systematic theology, shared two ideas that have greatly contributed to my intellectual and spiritual flowering. First, Parker introduced our class to a book entitled How to Think Theologically. He used this book to introduce the notion of embedded theology and deliberative theology. Embedded theology are all of the theological convictions that have been passed to us from family, spiritual leaders, and culture. Typically, embedded theology isn't harmful until it is, and we can't disconnect from it logically because we are so tied to it emotionally. For instance, if I were to say to anyone who grew up in the Black church context, God is good, it would not surprise me if someone responds all the time. It's embedded in us. Some statements we don't question or challenge. We simply accept it. Then there is deliberative theology. The root word is deliberate. When one deliberates, she or he thinks about a thought carefully and deeply. Deliberative theology invites us to ask questions, ponder ideas, rethink cliches, discard certain opinions, or explain why we hold so tightly to particular convictions. Now, when someone says God is good, there have been times along my journey that I respond by adding, yes, God is God. For me, goodness is God's essence. However, a mother who has to bury her child 1 week after giving birth to that child may need space to wrestle with the goodness of God, juxtaposed to her suffering and grief. Deliberative theology grants us space and grace to question and dialogue about the things of God. Sometimes we do not need a sermon or a lecture. We need to meditate, listen, and listen again. The second deposit Dr. Parker made into the life of my mind was a quote from Paul Tillich. In Tillich's tome, Systematic Theology, Volume 1, he argues a theological system is supposed to satisfy two basic needs: the statement of the truth of the Christian message and the interpretation of this truth for every new generation. This quote helped me understand that every responsible theologian must hold the truth of God's message while making it relevant for the social location and cultural context of the listeners she or he seeks to reach. Everyone who speaks about God is a theologian. The problem is everyone is not responsible. I believe what Kristian A. Smith has done in this groundbreaking work offers each of us space to deliberate and help us interpret the Christian message for this generation. It's time for people to stop canceling other people because they dare to think differently. Smith pushes back on some ancient doctrines. It is important for all of us to learn that doctrine and divine are not synonyms. A doctrine is a set of beliefs that a group or institution in power decides everyone should agree on and repeat. Have we considered that even Jesus pushed back from the set of Jewish doctrines of his day? Every time Jesus said, "Ye have heard it was said by them of old time, but I say unto you," Matthew 5:21-22. Jesus was trying to interpret a truth for a new generation. Smith is a follower of Jesus, and his thought-provoking work challenges us to hear the voice of God in a postmodern world. There is a hymn that I would hear sung in my home church, and I've discovered very few people believe the lyrics. The hymn is called "A Charge to Keep I Have," and it reads, "A charge to keep I have, a God to glorify, a never-dying soul to save, and fit it for the sky, to serve this present age, my calling to fulfill. Oh, may it all my powers engage to do my master's will." In this book, Smith's heart is to serve this present age. Smith welcomes us into an unfamiliar sanctuary, a space where all of the pews are in the pulpit. No one will stand to preach today, both preacher and people are invited to sit beside each other to converse and listen, and that's all. Please remember, as you sit in this space reading this book, if you know everything, then you don't need faith. And if you have faith, you don't need to know everything. Finally, whenever someone says something new or does something new, our first knee-jerk reaction is to reject it, resent it, or emotively respond to it. I pray this book ignites conversations without feeling the need to lead crucifixions. In the words of Dr. Howard John Wesley, my job is not to make you think like me. My job is to make you think. Christian Smith makes us think. Let's think together, and may we all leave this book knowing both God is good and God is God. Let the adventure begin. Reginald Wayne Sharp, Jr. Chapter 1, Gaping Holes. Where do I begin? This book has been a few years in the making. I have had people admonish me and others chastise me for waiting so long to write. So here I am in the midst of a pandemic coupled with the most severe race riots our country has seen in decades, writing about theology. How did I get here? I'm a preacher's kid, a PK. I grew up in the National Baptist Convention. Don't ask me which one. There are too many versions for me to keep track. My father was a Mississippi native who married my Texas-born mother in 1978. They moved to the Bay Area of California. In 1984, they gave birth to me in Oakland. I am a fifth-generation preacher. I would say Baptist preacher, but I'm not sure if that category fits me anymore. What follows on the pages of this book may suggest that I don't cleanly fit into any denominational category. My parents raised me to think for myself. My dad used to require me to state my case when I had a special request. I had to be able to logically explain why my request should be granted. I'm gonna say that again. I had to be able to logically explain why my request should be granted. This is the reason my wife, Pamela, sometimes says I should have become a courtroom litigator. I have been arguing cases since I can remember. For instance, consider this childhood episode. I had a midnight curfew in high school. My best friend had no curfew. So we would strategize how to build an argument to convince my parents to let me spend the night at his house on the weekends we wanted to go to the teen club or house parties. One condition I knew I had to meet was to be on the drum set at the church on Sunday morning for 7:30 service, ready to play. I spent many sleep-deprived mornings in the church during my high school years. But hey, that's the price a PK pays to hang out with our friends. My dad was also rather disruptive, which ties into how he taught me to think for myself. I've been exposed to women preachers for as long as I can remember. I didn't know that my dad was being disruptive in his denomination by licensing and ordaining women preachers back in the late 80s and early 90s. It was commonplace for me. It didn't come full circle for me until 25 years later when I was invited to preach at a church in the Bay Area in 2015. As is my normal routine, I sat in the pastor's office to clear my thoughts and pray before going out into the sanctuary for worship. When the pastor came to the office to lead me to the sanctuary, he stopped me and said, "Before we go out here, I need to warn you that there are women in the pulpit. I had the most perplexed look on my face as I responded, okay, that's great. Why are you telling me this? And he replied, well, I just like to put it out there. A lot of the pastors in this area don't believe in women preachers, and some of them have cut off fellowship with me because I have women preachers in my church. At that moment, I realized just how disruptive my dad had been 25 years earlier, and I actually wore it as a badge of honor. My parents also raised me to honor and respect other people, no matter their lot in life, whether it was the trans sex worker who worked the corner across the street from the church or the president of the convention. I have a heart for people because my parents modeled what that looked like for me. Looking back, I can see how my father's theological framework sometimes led him to make ill-informed statements about people, but I know his heart. I believe if he were alive today, we would be having some intense and lively conversations about the contents of this book. Even if he would not ultimately agree with my conclusions, he would have to appreciate the logic of it all. That is, after all, who he raised me to be. My dad was my favorite preacher, but he didn't try to force preaching on me as a vocation. I admired and imitated preachers growing up, but that was not my career aspiration. I played football, studied telecommunications and business administration at Alabama Agricultural and Mechanical University in Normal, Alabama, founded by William Hooper Council in 1875. I love my alma mater, in case you couldn't tell. My career aspirations were to be a corporate executive. I am equally as committed to being effective in the marketplace as I am to being a faithful minister. I am writing this book as I sit in the clothing studio of P Square Custom Clothiers, my family-owned clothing and wardrobe consulting firm. As much as I love the church, I see God in all aspects of society, including but not limited to business, nature, and sports. My theology is influenced by this worldview. And speaking of theology, I studied it formally at Mercer University's McAfee School of Theology in Atlanta, Georgia. It was during my time at McAfee that I was exposed to some inconsistencies in my theology. I can't shake how often Dr. Lloyd Allen, my church history professor, would drop some earth-shattering knowledge on us and then say, "Mama and them never told you that, huh?" I can't shake the first time Dr. Dave Garber, my Old Testament professor, exposed me to a Native American reading of the story of Joshua and the Battle of Jericho. I don't have the words to explain how it felt to hear a Native American say they identify with the non-aggressive people inside the walls of Jericho, whose city was besieged by the Israelites. Not to mention, Dave told the class that he's not really a fan of King David in the Old Testament. Dave is a member of my church now, so I have permission to call him by his first name. But seriously, who doesn't like King David? I mean, he was a man after God's own heart. Aren't we required to like King David? But hey, my parents taught me to think for myself. So my thought was, let's see where this seminary thing goes. In the proverbial words of my elders, I could just eat the meat and leave the bone. My seminary journey revealed to me that my embedded theology contained a lot of bones. By embedded theology, I mean the perspective of God my faith tradition instilled in me during my developmental years, which shaped my worldview. That's not to say that my embedded theology wasn't useful. I came to know God using my embedded theology. I just didn't know how many bones were mixed in with the meat until someone showed me that there are other perspectives to the story. I am very careful to not always tell people to think outside the box. That can be dangerous. There are some valuable lessons inside of our boxes. I met God inside of a box of male-dominated, patriarchal, National Baptist church life and theology. That box had and still has all types of flaws, but I met God there. God is inside the box. The problem is when we limit God to our box. God isn't relegated to the box where we met God. God is in my box. God is in my neighbor's box. God is also outside of all of our boxes. So by all means, think outside the box, but don't completely discard the good things you learned about God in the box where you met God. Nonetheless, I hit a wall in my faith journey as I was further educated about my faith tradition. I discovered that there were some gaping holes in my theological framework that I never noticed, primarily because of my privilege. I am a Black, heterosexual, cisgender, able-bodied male who was raised in the Black Baptist Church, one of the few places in this country where Black men have authority. Cisgender basically means that my gender identity matches the sex I was assigned at birth. I was assigned male at birth based on my genitalia, and I identify as male. The alternative to cisgender is transgender. Nothing about my theology was oppressive to me, except the shame and stigma surrounding sex in general. Most of us have dealt with that to some degree. Another book for another day. Yes, the perverted brand of Christianity that white colonizers handed to my African ancestors is harmful in every way. Their sanitized version of Jesus, which they used to pacify slaves, was diabolical. But that isn't the type of Christianity I practiced growing up. I never had pictures of white Jesus in my home. My parents always pointed out to me that the people in the Bible were people of color. I'll never forget my dad telling me at a young age that Jesus looked more like us than the guy in the framed pictures that hang on many Black people's living room walls in between Martin Luther King Jr. and John F. Kennedy. Here was his rationale. In Matthew chapter 2, verse 13, the angel of the Lord tells Joseph that he must flee to Egypt to hide because Herod is looking for Jesus so he can kill him. Why would God tell a blonde-haired, blue-eyed, pale-skinned person to hide out in an African nation? Joseph's family would have stuck out like a sunburnt thumb. I could go much further into this topic about how Black people think Christianity is the white man's religion, but that is not my assignment in this book. Let me stay on task. I said all of that to say that I grew up in a faith tradition that was very affirming of who I am as a Black man with the attributes I listed above. Once I was removed from my theological echo chamber and placed in a setting with a more diverse group of people of faith, I was able to hear much more clearly the cries of my neighbors who did not experience my privilege. I was able to clearly hear the cries of women who were marginalized by my faith tradition. I was able to clearly hear the cries of LGBTQ plus people who have been oppressed and ostracized by the very faith tradition that have formed and shaped me. And by diverse, I don't simply mean racial or ethnic diversity. too often that's the only thing that comes to mind when we say diverse. Sure, I did experience more racial and ethnic diversity in my theological education setting. But just as important, I encountered cultural and theological diversity. I studied alongside Africans who looked like me, but had a drastically different cultural lens than I did. I studied alongside Black women who looked like me, but had a different theological lens than I did. This forced me to come to grips with the reality that I was conditioned to use my critical thought in every aspect of my life except for my theology. I wasn't taught to critically question what I was taught in church. I was taught to accept it and adjust to it. My formal theological education didn't tell me what to think. It gave me permission to question. One of the hallmarks of my ministry is that my aim is not to provide answers for your questions. I want to provide questions for your answers. My theological education equipped me with the tools to carry out my questioning experiment. That experiment is what led to the curation of Greatest Commandment Theology. I'm careful not to refer to myself as the creator of Greatest Commandment Theology because I don't think I created anything. I think I just connected the dots that were already there. That's what it means to curate something. A curator organizes and connects dots. I liken it to the work I do as a clothier and stylist. I design clothes and shoes using fabrics, threads, buttons, and other materials that already exist. Then I organize the various garments and accessories to create an aesthetically pleasing presentation. I have the most fun when I encounter a client who doesn't have the greatest sense of style, but they know they want to look better. That's when my creative juices really get flowing. Greatest Commandment Theology is my spiritual style presentation. And it all started with me recognizing that my personal theological style had some deficiencies that needed to be addressed. What are those deficiencies, you may ask? That's a great question. Thanks for asking. Turn the page and let's explore them together. Chapter 2, Navigating Biblical Authority. My divorce. I endured a pretty ugly divorce from my first wife when I was about 26. I'll spare you the details because you probably wouldn't believe me if I told you the truth. Maybe I'll write a fiction novel one day and sell the rights to a screenwriter because that story is Sundance Film Festival worthy. Nonetheless, I grew up believing that divorce was wrong. Again, my father was my pastor, and he didn't condemn divorcees. How could he? He divorced my older brother's mom before he...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.